Welcome to Founderline, the show where we answer your questions about startups. I'm your host, Joe Beninato. Thanks for joining us today. It's great to have you all with us. Our goal with Founderline is to provide a forum where people who are interested in startups can get their questions answered by experienced entrepreneurs and investors. You might be someone who's thinking about starting a company. You might be a founder of a company and have a situation that you're working on. You might be an employee who's thinking about joining a startup or who's already at a startup and wants to ask a question about what's going on. In any of those cases, our goal is to try and help you, and we're here to help. This is a live show, and in order for this to work, we need your participation. You can reach us multiple ways. You can call us. The number is 1-844-4-FOUNDER. That's 1-844-436-8633. You can email us. The email address is help@founderline.com. And you can also reach us on Twitter. Our Twitter handle is @Founderline. With that, let's get the show started. Our guest today is Aydin Senkit, who's the founder and managing partner of Felicis Ventures in Palo Alto. He's an investor in a bunch of great companies, including Dropcam, which is now part of Nest and Google, Rovio of the Angry Birds fame, Twitch, and Fitbit. Aydin, thanks for joining us today. Welcome to Founderline.
Joe, thank you for having me.
It's great to have you here. So usually we start out the first few minutes just chatting about your background and asking a few questions just to get you warmed up and get everyone in tune. I was thinking back to your background, and you joined Google very early. I think it was 1999, right?
Correct.
So how big was the company then?
Well, it's interesting because when I first signed my offer, there were 30 people. When I actually started, my employee number was 63.
So holy cow.
In the 3 months it took for my H1B to switch from Silicon Graphics to Google, I think Google hired like 25, 30 people.
Wow. So that's amazing. Well, talk a little bit about what life was like there in the very earliest days. I don't know if you were in the Palo Alto offices or, you know, where Google was at that point in time, but walk us through what it was like back in the early days.
Absolutely. It was a very fascinating time. I started interviewing when Google was still on University Avenue in that lucky office, which has also been occupied, I think, by PayPal. They moved to Mountain View to their first office when I first started. It was a very special time. It was a collection of some of the smartest people I've ever met and I had the chance to work with. It was also fascinating in the sense that when I first started, I was the first PM there. And at first it was intimidating because everybody had a computer science master's or PhD, and I was the guy who spoke five languages, and Google was just about to go international. So they were like, you're the international guy, why don't you help us with the international launch, which ended up being my first job at Google, launching Google in 11 languages. It was a fascinating time also. I've seen some amazing things happen. A very interesting group of people, like some really interesting memories and stories. The first 100 people we had, I think we had something like 30 countries. It was like a mini United Nations.
Wow.
I think that was a special element. We had great diversity from the very beginning. And then the second thing is how differently people thought. Like I remember there was a time, a year and a half into our history, Alta Vista launched a $100 million marketing campaign, and then they were focusing on this advertising of the Alta Vista search engine, and we took a small budget and invested all in great engineers, some of which actually came from Alta Vista's own research group, and we channeled our efforts into really understanding how we could make search better, and that was a great example of how people at Google thought at the time, and any other company would have been totally intimidated by that kind of an offensive. And the search engines at the time were adding more and more features. And
Sure. We
found out that through our own research that one of the things that was really broken with search at the time is that people were having a lot of misspellings. Like we found out one out of every four search words was misspelled. And we ended up implementing that famous, did you mean, the Google spell spell check, which was a whole new technology back then. And it was implemented by one guy. And, you know, it was such a funny thing that we found out even something like Britney Spears, we found that there was 180 misspellings of the name. And then people would blame the search engine, oh, this search of socks, you know, look at the results.
Yeah.
Anyway, to make a long story short, it was so interesting to see a new company, a startup, thinking completely differently. And then, you know, in every aspect from then on, they always thought about, like, hey, how can we have a symmetric impact with out-of-box thinking? But that was a good example that I fondly remember.
Oh, that's awesome. And, you know, my memories of early startup days, those are the people that you're in the trenches with and you remain friends, you know, to this day, right?
Yeah, so, you bond. They're like family.
Some great experiences. So that's awesome. So then, you know, spent 5-6 years at Google and then started investing around 2005. Is that right?
End of 2005, early 2006. I took a little bit of time when I left Google. It was about a year and a half after the IPO. And I've seen Google go from 30 people to 3,000 people.
Yeah.
And the nature of the company was changing. There was more management layers being added. And I felt, you know, I kind of already leveraged all my strengths, and time kind of has come to find a new mission. And after I took a little bit of time off, kind of in a typical Silicon Valley fashion, I was talking to friends, and they were mentioning some startups, and I figured that I was really good at two things. I lived in four continents in my life, and for Google, I traveled to 40 countries. And what I realized is that I was very good at relating to people, even people whose language I didn't speak and cultures I wasn't familiar with. And then the second thing was I love strategy and I love numbers. It turns out that in venture capital and the tech startup ecosystem, being able to relate to founders is a key aspect of success in venture capital, because a lot of the best companies, it ends up being, can you establish a direct connection with the founders or not?
Right.
And then the second thing, obviously, you do need to have a strategy and you need to have a very good grasp of numbers. So it turns out that if you're really good at those two things, it gives you a good start in the investing world. And I started as an angel investor. I think the other nice thing was I didn't get into it to dabble. I really was serious about that being my own startup. And the interesting thing is, at first, I'm like, I have no experience in this. Maybe I should go spend a few years at a VC, venture capital firm. And what was really funny is, with the exception of one famous venture capitalist, the other ones that I talked to said that I didn't have a typical background and probably I wouldn't make a good VC and I should try on my own if I really believe I can do this. And that was probably one of the best things that happened to me, because it gave me that last impetus to go ahead and try it out of the box.
Oh, that's awesome. And now, you know, look, we're, what, 9 years later, right? And on what fund number? Third one? Or depends how you count, probably.
Exactly. Third institutional fund, fourth fund, if you count my angel investing days as the first original fund. And we're having a lot of fun and very proud of the companies and founders we're working with.
That's great. Well, in that time period, you know, the seed VC space has really evolved. And we've seen everything from, you know, the shift to less and less capital to then larger seed rounds that used to be called Series A. Now they're called, you know, there's pre-seed and there's seed. So maybe walk us through, you know, the evolution that you've seen in the seed investing space in that time.
Absolutely. I think when I started, you could probably count all the well-known angel investors. It was a couple dozen, and we all knew each other, and it was a very small ecosystem. And the activity was nowhere close to where it is today. Fast forward, I mean, it's actually really great for the ecosystem and overall that there were so many more seed funds, so many more investors, great development and evolution also of all the incubators and sites like AngelList and Funders Club. I think what's really interesting is venture capital is one of those things. For all the disruption we speak of, the ecosystem itself has not really been disrupted. And so one of the things that I wanted to do is, when I was angel investing on my own, I had the luxury of experimenting a little bit and thinking out of the box. And so the unconventional wisdom that I had is that a lot of people, when they start out in venture capital, try to optimize for two things at the same time. The brand itself, which I think is the most important asset, and also maximizing things like ownership and all of that. And so I think one of the most unique things we did is basically breaking or bending all the rules. For instance, we said, look, the only thing we care about, thematic investing, we're going to get into the best companies, and we're not going to care as much about ownership and other things. We can do more expensive deals. We can do deals outside of Silicon Valley, which at the time was anathema. We now have companies in 10 countries. And also, we've gone across stage as soon as we institutionalized. So I think the most important thing we realize is, look, our success is a derivative of our founder's success. So we need to do everything to make them successful. And the only thing that matters, or the most important thing for us, is basically the companies that we're in. So that's a very important thing. And it also took a lot of effort. I mean, the funny thing is, you know, this show is all about people that are aspiring entrepreneurs and entrepreneurs in general. And when I was doing my first own fundraise for institutional capital, I think I counted 135 different versions of my own deck. So the funny thing is, like, it's not like, oh my God, it's a totally different picture on our side. We had to work just as hard to get our own institutional funding. And we really relate to the founders, and our approach has been kind of leverage all the things that we know and all the things we learned through experience, and again, create that one-to-one dialogue and connection with our founders.
That's awesome. And having been one of your founders, I can attest to the strength of that that portfolio and the team over there. Well, that's great. Great walk down memory lane. And why don't we take some questions and see if we can help a few people out?
Let's do it.
So let's start out with, we have an email here from Mike, and it says, it looks like you have a large portfolio for the size of your investment team, which is three. You cover a large number of sectors and do both seed and VC funding. What advantages do you have that allow you to cover this wide spectrum of companies? Can you go into the process the team takes in choosing who to invest in?
Absolutely. Great start. So we have about 120 or so companies. And the other thing that we're also proud of, we have about 51 exits and a one IPO. So the interesting thing about that number is, luckily, we're having exits at a very good pace, as well as the new investments that we're making. So that number becomes manageable. It also includes quite a number of the original angel investments. I think the way we think about it is kind of counterintuitive. Also, our investment team consists of three partners, but also Dasha, who's kind of our investment operations colleague, who's actually super helpful, so I counted as four. The way we think about it is, you know, we have a mentality of making sure that whatever it is that we do for the founders is extremely meaningful. And rather than focusing on the quantity of time spent, we focus on something that is really meaningful to them. So I can go to a gamut and variety of things, but the things that we try to do is try to understand one or two highest priority item for a founder, and always do a good job exactly at the time when they need help in that very specific area. Sometimes it's help, you know, hiring of a key executive. Sometimes it's help with a strategic decision of, you know, a fundraise, or either, you know, trying to decide to sell the company or keep growing it. Sometimes it's a strategic partnership. Sometimes an important licensing deal. And we've always tried to make sure that whatever that one thing is or two, we do a good job at the time it's needed, but then other times get out of the way so that the founders can do what they do best.
Oh, that's great. And I remember working with you, and one of the biggest challenges, especially nowadays when you might have 10 or 15 investors, is you feel a lot of guilt. Like, you want to keep everybody up to date, but you can't talk to everybody every week, and you know, and they have 20, 30 companies, so they probably don't want to talk to you every week anyway. So just trying to find that balance. And, you know, I know it's a challenge, but Mike, I hope that answers the question for you and is helpful. We have another message here. This one's from one of our regulars, Larry from Yuba City. And it actually ties in with another question that came in, which is, what strategies do you consider when a big established company like Apple, Facebook, or Google moves into your space and encroaches very closely on your niche market? And that's very similar to the question we had, where it was, how did Apple's announcements of HealthKit, HomeKit, Apple Pay, and iWatch immediately impact the products that startups you're working with are delivering or will be delivering? So we'll kind of merge those two together just for the sake of argument here. So What happens when those big companies, those big gorillas come along and they roll over in their sleep and you know, land on top of you or whatever it might be?
Yeah, I think there are so many different layers to that. I mean, one thing is, I think we've actually benefited quite a bit from that because of the strategic investments we made. I think every major tech company has acquired a company from us. I think Google is at 8 or 9. We've sold at least one to Apple. And pretty much to every other company. I think what happens is, a lot of times, because these companies carry so much power, every single move is kind of interpreted in the moment that happens in a thousand different ways. But we've seen, for instance, with Apple, I mean, they had to recall all the HealthKit apps. I think, first of all, the move validates the strategic direction. I think this is a very important area. But the second thing is, just because a giant company is moving into that space doesn't immediately equate to a threat. It takes them a couple times to get it right. Yep. Sometimes it's not in their DNA and they don't quite get it right. In fact, I used to be asked all the time if, you know, Google's own social network, Google Plus, is a threat to Facebook, and I said, you know, it's YouTube, not Google Plus. So I think it takes a different kind of thinking to really interpret all of those things. But even in terms of our own investments, you know, our companies like Fitbit, I mean, you know, I think last Christmas they had 77% market share in wearables, and even after, you know, some of the things that have happened, the lowest they have ever been is still 50%. And I think it's a really important brand, and something like that just doesn't disappear overnight. So I'm still very bullish about the bets we made. But first and foremost, we focused on really formative, iconic products with a critical use case scenario. So I think as long as that happens, there will always be value, and these things are rarely zero sum type of situation. So
all right, and you mentioned 8 acquired by Google. So is that a coincidence that you worked there at some point, or is that you sort of working your magic and calling up a few friends, hey, you might want to look at this or that, or some combination of the two?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's so funny. I mean, when you see these things, there's automatically like some correlations implied. I think it just is that Google is a very active firm. They've been very active in M&A. They are very eager to get great engineers on board, sometimes through acquisition. I can tell you the one thing that has not been a factor is the people that I know there. I've been now out 6-7 years, which is unbelievable. But I think it's been, maybe because of my Google DNA, I think we really think alike in terms of the strategic areas. And luckily for us, the companies we backed seem to have found and striked a chord with the people at Google. And so far, not only am I excited about the exits, but more importantly, these companies have become important products within Google, which is also interesting. You know, when we talk about like making sure that our funders are successful, sometimes it means that through the acquisition, their product gets in the hands of 10, maybe 100 times, 1,000 times more people. And that to us is just equally as important as the exit itself.
Yeah, no, that's great. All right, let's see. We have one here from Bill. It says, what would you do if you met the perfect team with fantastic recommendations, great experience, super smart, and you really want to work with them, but their product idea isn't quite right? Would you pass? Would you tell them to come back with a different product? Would you invest and hope that they pivot? What if one member of the team isn't in the same league as the others? Would you tell them to dump me? Referring to himself, apparently. Yeah. So what do you think about that?
So there are multiple questions, so let me take it one at a time.
Sure.
I think one of the unique aspects about what we do is we are thematic investors, meaning that first and foremost, we choose a few special areas and we try to find the best companies in that. And within those areas, we've invested in companies where it was just a few founders and an idea on the back of a napkin, literally, proverbially, multiple times. And sometimes it's a company that is at a more mature stage because it's just not feasible that we're going to catch these companies early on all the time. It is most important to us that we basically get into the most important companies in areas we deemed critical and very exciting. I think the important thing here is we have two kind of important qualifications to decide to work with a company, and we always want to get a good feel for the founders, and we ask them what their product vision is. So I know that sometimes there might be a demo or plan that is imperfect, but more importantly, I think it's very important that we truly believe and have full conviction in how the founders founder or founders themselves define their success and what they think is kind of their secret or their unconventional wisdom to a great product. And if we buy into that, then I think the other details are not as important. And the team itself is a really big thing. I think we want to get great confidence about their capability to execute. You know, we do end up in situations where, you know, we cannot back every company that we talk to, but we try to make a genuine effort as much as we can to at least give good advice, stay in touch. Even at the time, if it's not a good match, then at least we try to give them some input. And there's been many times, in fact, I mean, one of the things that I'm proud of is one of our most exciting companies, ClearSlide, was referred to us by a founder we actually turned down. But the advice that we gave him was so useful and interesting and spot on, he actually never forgot about us. And when he had his exit, he came back to us and ended up referring a company. So.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, I think over time, as you get more and more companies in the portfolio, that really starts to accelerate the referrals.
Absolutely.
Right?
So, absolutely.
That's great. So let's remind everyone how to reach us if they'd like to send in a question. You can call us. The number is 1-844-4-FOUNDER. That's the phone number. You can email us. It's help@founderline.com. And you can also tweet to @Founderline, and we'll try and answer your questions. So let's see. Next, we have one. Perfect timing. Email from Edward, which says, what are the best sources of investments for you? Referrals from other investors? So we talked about one, which is other founders,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
In the case of ClearSlide, but what have you ever analyzed the data to see, 60% of our companies come from one source or whatever it might be?
Definitely. I think we have a healthy mix. It's definitely, I think if I was asked the top source or the source that we most care about, I would say it's twofold. One is the founders. Clearly, we do get some referrals from law firms and investors as well, but founders first and foremost, because they know our DNA and they know the DNA of the teams that they're referring us to. But I think one, again, unconventional thing about us, some of our most interesting investments like Rovio in Finland or Shopify in Canada, actually we're really proud of that one too, are actually companies we discovered on our own and never really came to us through deal flow. And we basically end up spending, and then Adyen in Amsterdam, spent a lot of time identifying and discovered them as like a company we believe to be the top prospect, to be the iconic company in that area, and we proactively pursued them. So I would say that's about maybe 20% of our deals, but in terms of the value it represents in our portfolio, it's closer to 40%, maybe even half.
Wow.
The other thing is, I think there's so many different deal sources. By always being focused on the thematic areas that matter to us, we try to be very, very reactive and respectful of the referrals and the entrepreneur's time. But we have a healthy mix. So
that's good. So Rovio is a great story, right? So maybe share with us, like how did you guys identify that? Where did it come from? And then my understanding is you pursued that for quite a while.
We did.
I could be mistaken, but
you're absolutely right.
Share that story if you
absolutely
wouldn't mind.
And in fact, it ties to another story of another great founder we had, Bart Dekram from Tapulous.
Yeah.
The reason why it's interesting is Bart's company, Tapulous, was the first company that started developing apps on iPhone before App Store itself actually existed. We backed that company, and one of the most important things that we learned from that, Bart tried a variety of different apps, but the only thing that resonated with users was games. And it started taking off, and Disney ended up acquiring the company. It wasn't a huge exit for us, but we immediately understood that not only was mobile going to be very big, but we also realized that the most important, the top area at the time, and we're talking 2010, in mobile was going to be gaming. And at the time, people underestimated that, and they thought Zynga is just going to also win gaming in mobile, and that's it. And we believe that there was going to be a different company with a different DNA that's going to be number one in mobile. So once we saw Rovio, I was actually on a panel at a mobile event. I ran into Rovio, and there were five other investors. We jumped on it right away, and there were a couple interesting things about them. Their game already was like number one, but only for a short time. More importantly, it ran on 6 platforms. Back at the time, you could hardly find any company that could run on their app on more than one, maybe 2 at the most platforms. So anyway, so that was an ominous start for us. We interfaced with them for about 10 to 12 months. We had 12 meetings in the US, in London, in Finland. And when the run ended up happening, actually the run was larger than our fund size itself. We were by far the smallest investor and the third investor. But there was one pivotal moment when in 2010, in Christmas, right before Christmas, they were like, look, we're going to do something crazy. This game is a super success. We decided to launch plush toys.
Yeah, I remember that.
But they didn't know how to do e-commerce. They came to us and said, it's 8 days before Christmas. We don't have an online store. Can you help us? I connected them to Toby, who's CEO of Shopify, and said, look, you know this game. It's awesome. We have 8 days. Can you put your best engineer? He did. Rovio launched on time, they broke the sales record, sold out their inventory in a few days, and at the time Shopify had 15,000 stores and this became number one overnight. Wow. Win-win, and it took a 40-minute phone call.
So. That's a value-added investor right there.
That's
connecting
right.
Portfolio companies and making great things happen right before Christmas.
So, right before Christmas.
That's awesome. That's a great story. So let's see, we have time for one more, I think, before we go on to thank our sponsors. So this one is from Jeff. It says, do you attend demo days like YC or Techstars? And if so, how do you decide which companies to focus on after 2.5 minutes? So, you know, we've all been to these events and it's, especially now when like YC has 80 plus companies, you know, you're sitting there and you're trying to pay attention and keep track of it. But so do you go to these events? And,
I do. In fact, I think I've been going to we've been involved with YC pretty much every batch except their very first batch. I was actually an original investor in the two YC funds. We've done a company probably from every major incubator and accelerator. I think that the magic and secret to these things, I mean, the very first YC batch I did was a dozen companies, now it's 84. I think it's very important that you go in there having made up your mind about the areas that are interesting to you. And it clearly, it's very difficult to make a call in 2.5 minutes. I think that is just the amount of time that's necessary for you to decide, here are the three or four companies I'm gonna spend time with, and then basically end up meeting them and figuring out if there's a good mutual match.
Yeah. And so so you figure that out, and is the whole team there with you? Like you guys are, or maybe one of you goes to one and somebody goes to the other?
All the different, exactly. I mean, we try to have some representation in these key events. We try to track them, you know, through various different methods. I mean, I think, you know, there is always the potential of amazing companies to come up from these, but because like this area has proliferated so much, there is so much noise, and so to find a signal amidst also hundreds of other investors, it's very difficult. It just requires a razor sharp focus and also good relationship building.
Yeah, no, that's great. All right, well, I think we have time to squeeze in one more here before we move on. So this one's from Stephanie. It says, when you receive a company intro via email, what is the one critical thing that makes you say, I want to talk to this founder versus ignoring it? So you probably get a lot of intros over email, I would imagine.
Yeah.
So Stephanie wants to know, what's the magic thing that pushes you over the edge to dig in a little further?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, let me use an example. So one of the lawyers that we know, first of all, I think we've done very few intros from that source for whatever reason, but we recently backed a company called Mark One that makes the smart cuff vessel. I almost missed the intro, but the idea was so intriguing. So coming back to her point, I think number one, you know, where the email comes from, if it's referred versus like a complete like inbound email. If it's an inbound email and we don't have any connections, I think the thing is that email is a little bit like a teaser. So I'm trying to look for two or three things to get my attention. Is the idea unique? Is it exactly in our focus area? More importantly, more than like a bunch of things in the kitchen sink, I'm looking some objective verification of why that idea is important and unique, some stats about the founders or the company that gives us some aspect of it that is really intriguing that allows us to basically take the time to go to the next meeting.
That's great. No, that makes a lot of sense. All right, so I think it is time to thank our sponsors. So relax, have a drink, you know, kick back a little bit. You know, this show really wouldn't be possible without the support from our amazing sponsors, Oric and Ustream. And let's start with Ustream first. You know, many of you are watching this live over Ustream right now, and it's through the efforts of Brad Huntsable and the team over there that we're able to bring you this show every week. You know, from the very get-go, when we got started trying to get this set up, it was literally a 10-minute process to get everything working together. And if you're thinking about doing some live streaming, whether it's a company event or you're putting on a production, you know, could be a show like this even, you should definitely go and talk to those guys. We even, you know, as we've encountered some issues over the months, you know, trying to do remote locations from Europe over the summer, which we did, or whatever it might be, whenever we have a question, they're always there to respond and to help us out. So if you want to find out more, you can go to their website and find them. It's ustream.tv. I'd also like to thank Mitch Zuckley and the team over at Oric. You know, I always tell people that when you're starting a company, you want to have a great lawyer that you're working with. And I've worked with Oric on multiple occasions. The team there has always been fantastic. Your lawyer is one of your most trusted advisors. Even though, you know, you're hiring them to take care of the legal paperwork and to do the financing docs or to do an acquisition agreement or whatever, whatever it might be, you know, more importantly, they've seen lots and lots of transactions. They've hired lots and lots of people, many more than you would ever see as a CEO, even if you've done multiple startups. So having that knowledge available to you is really critical. And your lawyer is one of your most important advisors. So make sure you get a good one. If you want to find out more about Oric, you can go to their website. It's oric.com, and I'm sure they'll be able to tell you more at that point in time. So we usually do our Ask the Lawyer segment right now with Mitch, but I guess we're having some technical difficulties, so we're gonna move on to a few more questions, and then as soon as Mitch is available, we'll switch over to the Ask the Lawyer segment. So let's see what we have in here. We did Stephanie's. Okay, here's one from Rick. It says, I am the CEO of a consumer startup, and we're down to about 3 months of cash. Those are always tough situations. Yeah. I get the sense my team is losing faith in me. Any advice on how to keep them motivated as I work day and night to try and raise our A round? So it sounds like maybe raise the seed round, you know, running low on cash. I've been in that seat, Rick, if that is your real name, I don't know that it is. I know how tough that is. So, you know, you've lived through this countless times.
In fact, I can think of so many examples. Not only have we tried to work with quite a number of companies to give them the additional runway so that they could have a second shot at goal, which then ended up changing the trajectory of the company. In one case, we actually had to fight against a larger investor and take a lesser exit to make an exit happen so that the company wouldn't run out of money. So I can very much relate to it. I think it's a very complex issue. There could be so many different layers to it. Part of it is, I think transparency is very important for everybody to understand. I think a lot of times founders, and look, I mean, I'm a founder of a venture capital firm myself, and we have our bad days. Sometimes, you know, you feel all the world's weight in your shoulders, and it's hard to share it with the team because the news are not that good. The reality is, I think, being transparent and having a singular vision of how to turn things around, and maybe being open to, like, maybe the team will come together and they'll have an interesting idea to change things. Maybe once they understand how dire the situation is, important and hard decisions that have to make could be made as a team, so they're actually less painful, and the sooner you make them, that can give you the additional runway. I think it's all about trying to bring as many options as possible and extending the runway just enough until that next run happens or some other alternative is found.
Yeah, no, that's great advice. And that makes me think of one other question, which is, you know, you and I have both been in the CEO chair, right? And there are those days when you do feel the weight on your shoulders. And I'm curious, you know, I always found, for me at least, it was helpful to have a couple of trusted advisors that I could go to and, like, not feel any, like full transparency, right? Yeah. Like, oh, this guy just quit today and it was our lead engineer, or, you know, like, whatever it is. Yeah. So what advice do you give your founders in those situations? Like, do you act as that sort of, you know, trusted advisor? Do you have them, you know, try and find some others who might be able to fulfill that role? How do you help them get through those things?
I think it's a very good point. And to be honest with you, it's funny, when people ask us, you know, what is some of the important things we care about? And a lot of times investors will say, we like to be on the boards of companies. For us, we want to be the first call for the founders. So establishing that kind of trust and relationship is very important. I think, look, I've been in that position on both sides of the table myself. I think one of the most important things is sometimes you have tough things and you have surprising things. You just want to know that you're not crazy. Sometimes the writing is on the wall and you just want somebody to say, look, you're not crazy. That really is the situation, or those really are the alternatives. A lot of times our function is, especially when you're in a quandary or in a tough situation, somebody from the outside can be a little bit more creative because they're not in the trenches. So I think, you know, our kind of MO has been very simple. Number one, can we put another option on the table? Or if there are only fixed options on the table, can we get extra amount of information so that the founders and CEOs can make a better decision? But it's never, you know, it's option A over option B. I think that's a very personal thing, and that decision is always up to the CEOs and founders themselves. And then finally, I feel like, look, you know, my own kind of philosophy is, not only are advisors really helpful, but my kind of own reading on this topic has been more like, I've read every single Navy SEAL and military book, because I think, and sports coaching, because I feel like our job as managers are coaching, inspiration, and leading by example. And sometimes we find the best examples in an area completely unrelated to tech.
I've never read, so you, Navy SEAL books, huh? That's
my team, I think, is sick of hearing me use Navy SEAL example and military example. I'm obsessed with it.
No, so. I think it's great. You know, one of the things I remember, you know, when we were doing Tello, and Aydin was an investor in Tello, and we went through some rough times. I remember talking to you. I forget if it was over the phone or we ran into each other on University Ave or something. And I, you know, there are some investors who, like, their first reaction to bad news is, well, why did that happen? Or why didn't you do this? Or, what, you know, sort of second guessing or sort of casting blame. And I remember, you know, in those situations, you were always, like, totally mellow, like, oh, you know, don't worry, we're going to figure this out. You know, is there something we can do to help with X or whatever? Because the reality is, you know, we're in the trenches, like, fighting for our lives, right? The last thing you need is for some investor to take a dump on top of you and, you know, pour a big bucket of water over your head, right? So I think having that support is critical. And, you know, at the end of the day, the team is, they have to figure it out. There's only so much you as an investor can do, right?
Absolutely. So, and our job is to be helpful. Whatever has happened has already happened. So
yeah, no, that's great. So, all right, well, let's keep moving here. We have another one here from Jack. It says, I'm a successful founder/CEO looking to move into venture capital. What qualities did you look for as you hired the other members of your investing team? So I know originally it was just you starting out as an angel, and then I can't remember, but I think you did the first institutional fund. It was still just you. Is that correct?
The team was literally coming together at the time.
Just starting.
My partner Sandeep was the first to join me, and then my other partner Renata ended up joining about 6 months later.
Okay.
Great question. I think one of the toughest thing is, this is a very tough industry where the only way to find out how smart you are is only like 8-10 years after the fact. And who remembers what actually happened 8-10 years before?
Right.
So it's very, very difficult to know if somebody has the right insights and the right qualification. I focused on two things. I experimented a lot for 4 years when I was an angel investor. And the only thing that I found that is virtually impossible to learn through experience is judgment. So one of the first things that I look for is, you know, other than obviously, you know, high caliber, high intellectual, all of that, is does the person have very good judgment? Do they have some counterintuitive insight to prioritize things and understand, you know, what type of companies or what type of areas matter? It doesn't have to be the perfect thing, but some kind of unconventional insight. And I think the second thing is passion and excitement to join a team. So the other thing that I realize is, look, I mean, I see a lot of people in venture because some of these firms have amazing brand names. There's a lot of money involved. There's kind of a tendency to put that as kind of higher than other things, but I also look for, hey, does this person a good fit to our DNA as a team, and do they actually want to join us, and are they excited to work with us? And even though we're one of the smaller funds and we're still up and coming and we still consider ourselves an underdog, are they excited to do something new and to actually roll up their sleeves? And sometimes that matters a lot. In fact, almost every meaningful job that I got, people thought I was misqualified, and the thing that always got it across the finish line was basically my demonstration of how badly I wanted that job and how much I care about it.
No, that's great. And I think that passion, you know, it's kind of hard to read that off of a resume, right? Like, yeah, it's something you experience firsthand.
Absolutely.
But so in the case of both of those people, were they people you had worked with before, or
they were not
brand new? You just met them, like, you know, on the street, or
there was some context. I think I had some working relationship in a kind of unrelated matter with Renata, and then with Sandeep, it was actually a referral from a friend of mine. And, you know, I think, you know, the thing that I was looking for is, again, you know, thinking in a similar way, and I'm really proud of them because they took a chance on me when literally, like, even our institutional funding was on the line. And I think that's also extremely valuable when somebody has faith in you before things start really working out, and
yeah,
kind of success seems a lot more highly probable.
Yeah, exactly. All right, well, that's great. Great question, Jack. Hope that helps you as you look for your move into VC. Here is a message. This one is from Thomas. It says, if I'm the founder of a YC company, what's the best way to get your attention at or after demo day? So we talked a little bit about this earlier, and for those of you who don't know, like, Y Combinator demo day, now there are like 80 plus companies. They all go up for 2.5 minutes, I think it is. And then there are breaks throughout the day where, and there's a little mobile app system where they can indicate their interest. But it is this kind of overwhelming thing. And yeah, even if you knew, like, you know, if Aydin knew he wanted to meet the founder of XYZ company, like, physically, it might even be hard to find that person in this,
yes,
space, because it's,
yeah,
at the Computer History Museum. So how does that work for you guys? How do you find these guys?
I think I have to give Sam Altman a lot of credit in terms of, again, instituting a lot of systems and a lot of interesting ways for investors to have a better dialogue with the founders. I think the other thing is, look, we backed, I think, at last count around 20 YC companies. So the chances of 20 YC companies,
wow,
total. For a YC founder finding another YC founder, we've actually backed. In fact, quite a few of our early bets have become YC partners. Justin Kahn and Michael Seibel from Justin TV, which became Twitch and became one of our largest exits. Gary Tan from Posterous, so on and so forth. So there are quite a number of our YC founders that we work with that are now partners at YC. You know, we are very responsive to not just the YC founders, but all other founders, but even for YC, absolutely fine to reach out directly, my first name at felices.com, or through one of the YC founders. They know us really well. They can also help establish a good fit. They already work with us. They know us. Depending on whatever it is this particular founder or any other similar ones are looking for, we also really care about the match being mutual and really great.
All right. Well, Thomas, good luck with that. I hope that helps out. They're still working on tracking down Mitch, so we'll keep working on that. The challenges of doing a live show. So let's move on. Here is one from Luca. It says, how actively do you use AngelList for investing?
AngelList. So Naval is a good friend of mine. I think he's done an amazing job with AngelList. We have backed AngelList companies including one called Alt12, which we're very excited about. I think there's a lot going on in AngelList that's exciting. It surfaces a lot of companies. I think it really democratizes the playing field. One of the things that I like the most about AngelList is the uniformity of all the companies in there. The system of, hey, look, here is every company. There is kind of like a higher order of like very short description of the company, all the company's founder and team, all the investors and advisors, all the kind of highlights, traction information.
Yeah.
I think it's a very great way for somebody to have very quick visibility into the company if it's going to be a great match or not. I think it also allows companies to kind of get exposure to a lot of investors at once. So obviously, there's so many different things to keep track of, but AngelList is one of the important ones, and we do pay attention to both the site as well as the emails we get from them.
Yeah, and it's just a tremendous resource. I remember when they first started as Venture Hacks,
yeah.
And Naval and Nivi had this great content, right? I was reading it and going, you know, people need to know more about this,
yeah.
right? Because
yeah.
these are the deep, dark secrets yeah. that we need to get out and tell the world about,
Absolutely.
Right? You know, how liquidation preference works or,
yeah.
You know, whatever it might be. And it's just turned into this great platform. And I don't know if you guys have done it, but I've noticed, like, Foundry Group, Brad and the team over there have started to do their own syndicates even.
That's right.
So have you guys branched out into that area, or you're still... You don't have your own, you know, syndicate fund.
We have not.
Okay.
We have not. I think, you know, as in everything, there are so many exciting things going on and there are a lot of changes going on. I think we try to like focus on really like in our niche and our circle of competence and being really good at that. So we have not done that yet, but also we're a small team and a small fund. With the earlier question of, we do have an exciting number of companies that we really care about. So we're kind of prioritizing that number 1, 2, and 3 rather than some other channels and other methods.
Makes sense. All right, good. Well, let's move on. We have another question here from Bob. It says, should I take money from someone I don't really like? So I don't know if you've ever had a startup founder say, you know, I really don't like you, but I want to take your money anyway.
Yeah, I guess there are two answers. Let me start with the more honest and the very honest and transparent answer is, I hope you never have to. I certainly organize and arrange things in my life and work very, very hard. I didn't have to. I mean, we have the same problem that the founders have, especially in venture capital. LP world is very opaque. There are very few numbers of their numbers are not very large, and a lot of times you have to deal with people that don't kind of resonate and with the mission of the firm. I very much relate to it. I think one of the biggest luxuries any human being can have is to be able to choose not only who they take money from but who they work with. So to the extent that there's anything this person or you can do to not have to do that, it would be great. But let's also be realistic. I mean, sometimes we just have to do it. In that case, I would basically think very long and hard the price you have to pay, like how much does that money allow, what does that allow you, or what does that enable you, so you would have to put up with working with somebody you don't like? Because I tell you, that's even though there isn't an implied, obvious, explicit cost, there is a huge cost to it, but it's something that you only experience and understand after the fact.
Yeah. I mean, those deals with the devil are sometimes challenging. And all I'll say is I've had to do that in the past, not with you, so it wasn't yeah. him, but you live to regret it afterwards.
Yeah.
And it might seem like, well, it solves a short-term problem, but it's the same thing, I think, with hiring someone who maybe isn't exactly the right fit, but you really need a front-end engineer. And, you know, this guy, Tom, well, he's like 60% of the way there. We're going to take a chance.
Yeah.
You're better off just waiting,
yeah.
you know, for something better to come along.
Yeah.
And I know, especially when... there are mouths to feed, and
yeah.
you have employees who are
yeah.
relying on you, and you know maybe the ship is going to go down. Do everything you can to find some other way, because usually, if your gut instinct is telling you there's not a good match there, or your personalities are off,
yeah.
it's only going to get worse
yeah.
once you sign on the dotted line.
Absolutely.
So,
absolutely.
So yeah, think long and hard about that one. I know those are tough situations. So let's see here. Here's a great question. So it says, how do I find a co-founder? So I don't know if you've been in situations where maybe you have one great technologist who needs a business person or vice versa.
Yeah.
So do you ever help with those situations or?
You know what? Actually, this was a real case. My partner Sandeep connected the two co-founders of Apurify, which ended up being acquired by Google. It's a very exciting development, obviously. You know, I cannot really say that, you know, it's one of the automatic things we do. Sometimes everything kind of lines up and we are able to do that. I think that is one of the hardest things is like, you know, asking somebody like, well, how do I find a partner or wife or husband? It's a very tough question and it's very personal. I think everything is fair in love and war. So I think what I would advise is, look, I don't think like for a lot of these things, there is no secret bullet. There's no magical answer. Like you basically got to do whatever it takes. The thing that I always focus on is just increase the probability. You know, our firm is called Felices and it means good fortune, but you know, our motto is engineering serendipity. So sometimes the best way to get lucky is improve the odds of getting lucky. You know, like that means that, hey, if there is five things you've done, try to do 10 things. If you spend an hour on each thing, try to spend 5 or 10 hours. And a lot of times it's patience and, you know, really figuring out also what the right, sometimes these things are related. You really have to have a good, crisp picture of what qualities would make a great co-founder. And then, I mean, to be honest with you, what I've seen most often, a lot of these matches also do happen in accelerators or incubators, or sometimes in school, sometimes in work. The thing is, those are the places you're constantly in the trenches and spend a lot of time with people.
Right.
And that is the best time to see what somebody's made out of.
Yes.
It's not gonna be like a 5 minute, 10 minute, 1 hour conversation over a great meal. It's more like day to day, what is this person, you know, is like to work with, how are they in good and the bad? And,
yes,
and
yes.
That's unfortunately something you can find over time.
Yeah, and you know, I've done both where I've done something with people I knew and people I didn't know, and you never really know what people are going to be like when the tough times come along, right? And so
absolutely.
Having the advantage of having worked with them through some tough times, you see what their true color, are they gonna bail out and run for the hills, or are they gonna like dig in and try and figure something out? And because startups have so many of those bad situations, you know, they're ups and downs every day, every week, right? And so those are really tough. But yeah, if you can find somebody who you know, that's great. But I also know there are things like founder dating now, which sort of connect some people together. I think a lot of you know, networking events, great place to sort of meet people. So also the unfunded incubator companies, they tend to sort of churn around, right?
Yep.
And if they can't raise money, many of those people still want to do a startup, but maybe it wasn't the right idea or something. So that might help out as well. All right, here's another one from Tim. It says, how much of your investment decision is product versus team versus market? So great question, right? And maybe it varies depending on each situation, but you know, it comes down to how do you make your decisions to invest in something?
Yeah, I mean, in an ideal world, obviously we would like to maximize all three. I think one thing that we do to be able to streamline our decision making and to kind of be a good partner to our founders, we think about the markets a lot. And I think that's why we're thematic investors, because if you've already thought about it a lot and kind of thought about, even if we haven't seen the perfect company, what would be the elements to make a company great, I think that kind of already preps our minds. When we come across a founder and company and when they're telling us why they're special and why they're going to be the best, the fact that we've done a lot of thinking on it is a huge help. I think, you know, again, not to be cliche, but team is very important. When it comes to product and team, we have two unconventional methods. Number one, I think we kind of ask them, very importantly, we try to get a very good sense of what makes the product or the service really special.
Yeah.
I think that's a very important question. But the second more interesting question is we ask them how they define success for themselves. And that is such a loaded, open question. And what I really like about it, you know, our philosophy is we want to be completely aligned with our founders. And the funny thing is, even if the product team and market is really great, that doesn't mean that we would be completely aligned with the founders. They might have a completely different vision of how they define success. I think that is very important in three different ways. Number one, it tells you how big the founder is thinking. Number two, it tells you, depending on how sophisticated their vision of success is, have they already thought about the critical success factors that's going to kind of make them realize how they're going to get there. And then the third thing is the way they define success is very important. And by making that question very open-ended, we kind of get a glimpse into their mind. And are they short-term thinkers and they're just kind of caring about the raise and haven't really thought about the fine details, or they are so detail-oriented and have such incredible grasp of what they're building that by asking this question, we get a very good glimpse into their vision of how many details they have thought of. And these things are very telling. And hopefully it can also serve as an example to other people who are listening in and to the audience in terms of, I think it's an important thing to really think hard about these questions before you're having that discussion, and kind of ask yourself, if you were at the other side of the table, what are the toughest questions, and kind of answer it in your mind, and it also primes and refines your thinking.
Yeah, no, that's great. And so it sounds like, you know, a combination of all of those, but it was really interesting to hear you talk about how they define success. And I was trying to think back to, you know, for previous companies, you know, what I answered in response to those questions, but that's really helpful. I think we have time for one more here, and this one is an anonymous question. It is, how do you make a decision on the valuation of a company? So there's lots of discussion around, convertible notes, and are they capped, yeah. and you know, should we do an equity round, yep. and all that sort of stuff. So, how do you decide on that? Like, are you setting the valuation usually, or do you let the entrepreneur do that?
A great question. I think it's somewhat related to the legal nature also. Very quickly, just to wrap up the last question, you know, when I was talking to Rovio and they had, I think, tens of millions of users, and the first thing they told me is, our vision is to become a billion DAU company, and we want to be like Coke. We want to be able to touch a billion people around the world every day.
Wow.
So that's just the craziest thing I heard, except that they were able to get very close to it, and they're still working on it. Coming
that's
back
awesome.
To the pricing, valuation, and convertibles. Now, I think one of the unique positions that we're at, in the beginning of our conversation, I was able to share with you that we had 51 exits and one IPO. The interesting thing about that, we went back and spent a lot of time in terms of what are the common factors, and one of the interesting things we found is there is no correlation to the valuation that we
really?
Put into the company. And the thing is, a lot of times, you know, higher valuations don't always mean it's a bad value for the investors. I think sometimes they're really correlated with teams that have a lot of experience. It's a supply and demand thing. So higher valuation can also indicate this is such a special idea and team that a lot of people are interested in. And as such, the founder has the ability to raise the price. I think the only thing that we're looking for, we are not valuation sensitive, but I can also tell you that we will pay any price for any deal as long as we can have a framework around it. We are pretty much willing to do any deal. Sometimes the price is high, but what we look for is how unique is the company's product, how strong is it, is it growing so fast? Sometimes you're just paying it forward 6 months or 10 months, and we're willing to take that risk as long as there is some fundamental aspect and some framework where we can justify how we come at that valuation. And if we've done our homework and, you know, we're really resonating with the founders and the team that we want to work with, we make it happen. We do have the luxury sometimes to be able to lead the deals, and in which case we determine the price. The one thing that we're religiously careful about, we want it to be a win-win deal, and we want the price to be mutually set. We want founders to feel good about the valuation. We're not trying to optimize every single penny, because the goal is always not just what's the share of the pie that you're getting, but to make sure that the pie gets as big as possible.
Well said. No, that's awesome. So, well, unfortunately, we're out of time. You know, Aydin, thanks for being such a great guest. It's great to have you today.
Joe, I really appreciate it, and thank you. And thank you for the questions. Really enjoyed answering, and look forward to continue the dialogue on Twitter and other sources.
Yeah, and you can follow Aydin on Twitter. His Twitter handle is asenkut, A-S-E-N-K-U-T. And also his firm is at Felicis Ventures, and you can find them there. Tune in next week for another episode of Founderline. Our guest will be Russ Siegelman. Russ is an old friend, a former partner at Kleiner Perkins, who's now an active angel investor and also teaching several classes over at Stanford Business School. So we'll have a great time catching up and hearing more about what he's up to. That's next Thursday at 5 o'clock Pacific time. Thank you once again to our great sponsors, Oric and Ustream. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter. Our handle is at Founderline. You can email questions in advance for next week to help@founderline.com. You can check out our website and you can subscribe to updates. We'll send you a weekly email. You can watch the previous episodes. You can also find out more about the upcoming guests and even subscribe to our podcast on iTunes. Thanks for watching. Here's to the crazy ones, and we'll see you again next week.